Less attending to the clinical significance of the clinical value of sleep from one side, and also the clinical significance of sleep disorders. Yeah, we've been around more than like 80 types of different sleep disorders, and that they are huge and they are very, you know, interdigitated in terms of the symptoms that people come up with and the kind of diurnal symptoms or carry-on effects that they would experience during the daytime function. So we know that sleep is really important, and meanwhile it is being less attended. That's the significance, that's the salience of putting the sleep into our center of attention when we're talking about sleep from the brain mapping perspective. We need to add some value to the general understanding of the importance of sleep on the effect of sleep on general health, on cognitive health, behavioral aptitude, and also to brain health in general. So we all know that we got around like 10 to 12 larger scale brain networks. Predominantly, we're talking about 3-4 of them most of the time when we're discussing the relevance between the resting state functionality of the brain and also, you know, task concurrent brain functions of brain dynamics. One of them is a default mode network. And between the default mode network and the visual network, acoustic network, attentional network, and also we have the central executive network, between these 4, 5, 6 networks, we've got like an interplay of a coherence between the similarity, the frequency similarity, or the amplitude similarity. The brain oscillations are going to get kind of similar, so by that they are functionally connected. And that's what we normally refer to as functional connectivity. And when we have this flip-flop of the brain functionality, when we have this, like tranquility, just switching and making a transition from wake to sleep, is when we're going down to the slumber and start to have the shallow sleep, then the N2 sleep, then the deep sleep, then there's like a smooth transition and the kind of the oscillation morphology. So by that, we know that the kind of connectivity meshwork that we can expect between different hubs and different nodes of the brain and cortical functions are getting altered when we're moving from wake to sleep. And vice versa, when we're just getting back from sleep to wake and we start experience arousal, when we start experiencing arousal and then we come up to the state of wakefulness, then again the connectivity and the functional connectivity mapping of the brain is changed. So there's like a dichotomy between the shapes and also the dynamics of the brain oscillations across specific key cortical hubs that we're going to touch on across this talk. So I'm going to walk you through some of the main ideas regarding the neurofunctional connectivity dynamics and the significance of that when it comes to cognitive function. So when we do not sleep well, our brain would lose this capacity of just, you know, switching into the processing mode over N2 sleep and just process and reprocess, sort of reverberate data from the deep-seated subcortical areas with the cortical areas of the brain. So this flow of the information back and forth is getting the data well consolidated, getting the data well, you know, readily accessible. So by that we can do the retrieval if we're talking about the concept of memories, if you like. Okay, so that's the whole thing. So I'm going to talk about the sleep from a brain, and what we'll be more in depth dealing with is the neurofunctional connectivity when it comes to the transition between wake to sleep and vice versa. So as I said before, based on the latest classifications, International Classification of Sleep Disorders, and the classification of sleep predicaments as per the American Academy of Sleep Medicine 2020, we have more than 80 types of sleep medicine, 80 of sleep disorders in sleep medicine, to be precise, 84. And some of the main and most prevalent sleep disorders are summarized here, ranging from circadian rhythm sleep-wake disorders to breathing-related sleep disorders when people have this loud snoring, or they have hypopnea, the cessation of stoppage or limitation of the airflow. They have a problem in delivery of the oxygen from the lung to the brain and to the blood. And by that, they wouldn't have this specific, you know, sleep stages or sleep cycle integrity is negatively affected. Well, also we can be more discussing about the hypersomnolence or excessive daytime sleepiness, which is a very important issue when it comes to the road traffic accidents and also work-related errors and so on and so forth. One of the main things that people are suffering from these days, specifically after the issue of COVID, we see that many people are suffering from insomnia. So that would be sort of tantalizing idea to touch on how the brain oscillations and the network connectivity meshwork of the brain cortical hubs is getting changed when we have long COVID, or when we have sort of like the long-term consequences of COVID-19 effect on the brain and psychological health. Some people also have the restless leg syndrome. When it comes to sleep, they tend to express symptoms compatible with periodic leg movement disorder. Narcolepsy, although not prevalent, but very, very salient stuff, and we need to have our eyes open to narcolepsy and to raise the awareness at the public level. And people have sleep attack nightmare disorders, REM sleep behavioral disorders, non-REM sleep arousal disorders, and substance or medications. And the last four of the list here are categorized into behavioral sleep disorders, which has been my area of focus in sleep studies and sleep neuromedicine for the past 10, 15 years. So what now we're doing is that we got a brain mapping laboratory, and what we're doing is that we have functional near infrared spectroscopy set up, quantitative electroencephalography set up, and also functional MRI in some settings. So what we're doing is that we are giving, this is how it works. We're giving some cognitive tasks or evaluations or whatever you want to do as a preliminary assessment for subjects who are coming to our doors, to our labs first. Then we give, I'm talking about sleep, sleep research in particular, not clinical practice. And then we give some of them a chance to take nap. Some of them would not get a chance to take nap. And after that, in the evening time, we're going to retest, we're going to reassess and kind of reimaging and evaluation, make sure that what has been the impact of the sleep on that specific, consolidated cognitive performance, or those who have slept or those who haven't, are there any differences if they are being matched age and other variables being matched across the groups? Is the isolated effect of sleep something to tap on, or how? So we're using quantitative analysis, source localization using S-Loretta and Loretta. Also, we're using NeuroGuide, other platforms that we're using is MATLAB, the EEG, EEG Lab as a plugin in MATLAB. This is what we're using. And based on that, it turns out that similar studies in the world are also tapping into the significance of sleep loss. This is something like a tsunami of these days. Specifically in the youngsters and the middle-aged population, because of the competitive lifestyle, because of reverse circadian rhythm disorder, use of technology, the increased screen time for teenagers. This has been outrageous. I mean, that many of them are not taking or having enough in terms of quantity and proper in terms of quality of sleep. Some studies have demonstrated that when we have sleep disorder breathing, there is a cross correlation between SDB or apneas or sleep. So when it comes to the sleep disorder breathing, there has been reports showing a cross relation between depression and other mental illnesses, other mental predicaments, and SDB or hampered oxygenation to the brain. Also, we know that when we have the frequency in insufficient sleep periods, then anxiety and depressive symptoms has been the case in some studies across the United States and Europe. So similar studies have also been showing that when we have the adverse childhood experience, we would have sleep disturbance into the adulthood. And also we have published similar reports regarding the relation between the psychological disorders and the relation between this total sleep timing and psychological or behavioral aptitude and mental health across university students. In our research, which was published by Allen in 2017, it was shown that in a study in the US, it was shown that when the youngster populations were, they were not youngsters, actually between 18 to 25, they were, you know, when a proportion of this population were taking less than 6 hours of sleep over 24 hours, then 63.8% of that population started to develop serious psychological distress, or in long run, in a follow-up of 3 months, they started to complain of serious psychological distress. And amongst the same population, almost 30% showed they have like a non-serious psychological distress. And by psychological distress, the study meant hopelessness, sleep difficulties going on and on, low energy, appetite issues, a feeling like failure, difficulty concentrating, and a fidgetiness or a slowness, and something like that. So subjects start to have all those untoward, mental behavioral presentations when they were reporting less than 6 hours of total sleep time over 24 hours. So that's what we do. When people come to us, we are receiving almost like 40 to 50 a week, and we just need to concentrate. We do the evaluations, the clinical evaluation, history taking, neurological, psychological, and psychiatric evaluations and examinations. And a proportion of these cases would need to undergo sleep tests, because we cannot talk about the bioparameters and changing in sleep variables unless we do the sleep test. We got a setup at the hospital and the Brain Institute that we're running. So people are spending one night at the hospital or at the sleep laboratory or in home setting when it's applicable. And then we're getting all these physiological data from them. So this is at least comprising like 6 channels of EEG, but normally we do 21 channel when we're talking about the brain mapping hypothesis or questions of research. So in our neuro PSG setup or neuropolysomnography setup, we're using 21 channel full-fledged QEEG, but normally in clinical practice, what you can see here is what's practically done. We have video surveillance, we have all the sensors being attached to the body to capture data from the brain signals, from eye movement, from the flow of airflow, and also from the chin EMG, legs EMG. We have we also attach sensors to the body of the subjects to evaluate their chest and abdominal movements, also the heart rate and all the different variables of the heart rate. And also we check the oxygenation of the blood through the pulse oximeter. And body position with the accelerometer, and we do the IR video surveillance overnight, so everything is under control, if you can see here, and you can admit that. So what I'm going to talk about is the functional connectivity. I know that. So how the brain macrostructure is being evaluated? Well, first we look at the EEG signals, and we stage the different phases of sleep. So we know that overall in one sleep cycle, we have 4 stages, predominantly N1, N2, N3. N2 is predominant, and N1 and N3 are taking the less proportion of the whole chart. And also we have the REM sleep. So N1, N2, N3 REM is one sleep cycle. This is called macrostructure of the sleep. And how we are labeling, how we're scoring the sleep EEG by looking at the EEG signals morphology. So when we do the scoring, then okay, we're done with the macrostructure labeling. But what happens to in more depth layers of brain activity? How about even more in-depth questions? What happens in the brain? How the brain connectomics is getting involved when we go through these stages, when we go through these cycles, and how we get aroused? What happens with our brain with would fortunately have the capacity to wake up, because if we do not have the capacity to wake up or to arouse in face of fear or in face of a threat, perhaps we have been facing so many life-threatening events so far, we probably couldn't have made through it. So the thing is that this arousal dynamics, this arousal instability is really helpful towards our survival, unless we couldn't. And that roots in the whole evolution. If you look at the other vertebrates or mammals, you see that for example, a rabbit is sleeping there and a cat is approaching a rabbit, the rabbit will arouse just at the drop of the hat, and the rabbit will fly and just, you know, saves its life. So that's because there is a good threshold of arousal instability. So when the threat, either the smell or the sound or whatever, is being captured by the sensory system of the prey, then that animal will sense the threat and just move away. And that's the same story in our brain. Through the evolution, our brain has got this fluctuation of the brain oscillation morphology and patterns, and we have this on and off, flip-flop changes in arousal level. And as you can see in the middle of the slide here, a little while before it, you can see that we have like a distribution of the K-complex, that there are transient bizarre shapes, slow activity. Then after that, you'll see that there is like an arousal. Within this arousal, you see a prominent distortion in the brain EEGs. At the same time, you see that the EMG of the chin is increased. The guy is just, you know, grinding the teeth and just swallowing his saliva. And the breathing is getting even more rapid. Then everything is back to normal, you see. And here also, he is kicking as well. And you see in the video that, yeah, he's kicking. And the leg EMG shows that he has got leg movement. At the same time, he's got tooth grinding, and the brain EEG is getting well aroused. And that's what's happening. Again, here, you see that in the N2, we have arousals that they are the case when we have changes in a background oscillatory activity. You see, this is the background. This is the background, okay? They can be well isolated. They can be easily isolated, 1, 2. But at the middle of the page in the box, you see that the amplitude and frequency of the brain oscillation and brain waves are getting dramatically changed. But before that, we have a transient slowing with a couple of isolated K-complexes, if you can admit here. And by that, you see that, well, this is called arousal. But the transition of arousal background is just making this like the wave in the sea. You see, this is like an oscillation. This is like a tonality in the brain. And that would help us to have this micro arousal instability, that the brain has the silky sweet slumber. At the same time, the brain has this alertness. The brain is getting alerted. When there's a risk or something, the brain gets, you know, the red flag up, and then we wake up again, we go down to sleep. Sometimes we arouse and we are confused, we don't remember, we don't reconsolidate data, we are not oriented to time, person, and place, then we come back to sleep. Sometimes we arouse, then we awake. So after awakeness, we might be using bathroom, getting out of the bed, coming back, getting back to sleep, and so on. Okay, so these are really kind of dependent, these fluctuations of the brain shapes. So we have the phase A and phase B. This is like a cycle, isn't it? So these cycles, that they are microstructure of the brain oscillations in N2, non-REM stage 2 sleep. The phase A, as you see here, is the slowliness or transient slowliness and increased amplitude in the brain waves. And then B is the background. So yeah, okay. So we had arousal and background. Again, we had here arousal and background, arousal and background. So by that, you see this A and B is alternatively being repeatedly, taking place. So these A, B, these are the cyclic alternating patterns, okay? And that's why we call them CAP. So from now on, I'm going to refer to that as CAP, or cycling alternating patterns. So each of those cap cycles comprise A and B, phase A and B, and when we have the consequences consequently occurring, cap cycles like A, B plus A, B, that would be a cap sequence, all right? And here at the middle of the page, you see some K complexes, these guys that are here in the middle, and also you have, again, A and B. So by default, by definition, we know that when we're trying to label the caps in the electrophysiological findings of the sleep, it should be, the cap cycle A plus B should be between 2 to 90 seconds. So if it is less than 2 seconds, we're not going to label that cap. If it is more than 90 seconds, again, that's not cap. So why cap is important? So if you can acknowledge here in this visual, if you zoom out and look at the page from a different perspective, you'll see that, well, the background is the background, it's there, but out of nowhere in the middle, somewhere in the middle, we have some blocks, some segments of changes in the brain oscillatory patterns. And we have a transient slowing across the derivations. So this changes in background oscillation is called phase A. So the yellow boxes here are the phase A of the cap cycles, if you would agree. And after that, we again have the B. So this is A, this is B, and again, A, B, and A, B, right? Okay, so now, so that we know something about the importance of cap, question is why we have caps? One is, okay, that's the evolutionary perspective, and we need that for survival. So what? What else? Is that being even more concerned in terms of our higher order cognitive functions or higher order brain functionalities? Presumably, yes. So that has got us to think that probably there is a cross correlation between the cap density and the distribution of the cap signals. Either we're talking about the phase A or phase B or the cap cycles or the cap sequences across the brain cortical regions. So we asked the subjects in one study coming to our laboratory, we gave them a set of neuropsychological testing batteries, namely CanTab, which belongs to the University of Cambridge. So they did the test somewhere between 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. And then they had a snack, they had lunch, and some of them were given a chance to nap, some of them were not given a chance to nap, and 5 p.m. in the evening we test them. So there were 104 cases that were studied in our NAP studies in a hospital and also in a setting at the Department of Neuroscience at Shiraz University of Medical Sciences, the data being finalized for a final report, although the preliminary and interim report of that data has already been published, and I'm going to show you the results in a while. So they are stratified into 5 groups as per their age classification, 13 to 18, 19 to 25, and so on. And we have been trying to kind of source localize the distribution of the slow component of cap, which is oscillating between 0.25 to 2.5 hertz. And through this scalp topographical mapping, it turns out that the phase A of the cap across the age groups and all the study population are being sort of like localized in the frontal part of the brain. So when we have the frontocentral areas as the areas of focus, we see that many of the slow components of the cap signals are being recorded and are being distributed there. And a little while later, we'll talk about why that could be salient stuff. Why is that important? And concerning the rapid component of the cap signals, i.e. the 7 to 15 hertz of the cap, the topographical mapping likewise showed in the same population group that despite the frontal distribution of the slow phase of cap, the rapid phase of caps are being distributed in the central and biparietal areas of the brain. So you see that parietal, occipital, and biparietal areas of the brain, and also the central parietal areas of the brain are more important for the distribution of the rapid component of cap. So before I move on, I'm going to further discuss a little bit about other types of sleep microstructures. There are not only caps that they are generally referred to as microstructures. We also have the sleep spindles. And we all know that we have sleep spindles, but sleep spindles are kind of, you know, classified into slow sleep spindles and fast sleep spindles, or SSS, FSS. So when the oscillatory patterns of sleep spindles exceeds 13 hertz, then that would be FSS. When it's less than 13 hertz, that would be SSS. So and we know that by the bunch of evidence that they are existing till now, evidence has postulated the fact that there is a correlation between the distribution of the sleep spindles and the proportion of N2 and the cognitive functions and the frontotemporal or frontal limbic reverberation of the data. So the flow, the information flow, the phase lag, the cross-frequency coupling which happens, also the kind of functional connectivity, the coherent Z-score, everything is getting, you know, influence when we're talking about N2 neural dynamics. And there's a cross correlation between those very minuscule microstructural signatures in sleep, mainly in N2, and other cognitive behavioral motor functions. You name it, you just go for it, literature, you do the search, and you'll see that there are pile of evidence showing a correlation between motor learning, between executive functions, attention, memory and learning, and decision making, a wide range of research and linguistic studies. And that's not only on healthy individuals, but also on diseased population. For example, think about the significance of sleep predicaments in a population of patients with MS, or with patients with a stroke, or with patients with, you know, what I'm going to talk about. So there are a wide range of neurological psychobehavioral aspects of disorders, and we need to tap on sleep because sleep is really of the brain, for the brain, by the brain. And we are spending 200,000 hours of sleep during the life if we're going to stay alive for 7 years. Yeah, 200,000 at least. In 6 years of our life, we're dreaming. So REM sleep should be something significant there. Let's think about that and do a bunch more research. So we did more in-depth analysis in a subgroup of the cases that there were 40 cases. We did the Loretta analysis for the CAP slow component localization. It was found that the slow component of the CAP was more localized in the frontal part of the brain, in the anterior cingulate cortex. And also we have had that in the ventromedial prefrontal area. So anterior cingulate cortex and BMPFC bilateral were the area of predominance for those slow components of the CAP signals when it comes to the source localization. For the fast component, for the rapid component, again, we found that, well, they are being more distributed and they are being more localized in the deep seated areas, in the central occipital and bipyramidal areas of the brain. So when it goes down to the subcortical areas of those voxels, you see that more of the voxels that they are getting, that they are being considered as hotspots here, they are in the parietal and central areas of the back of the brain. Okay. And not only that, that's not only the best part. The more beautiful aspects of studying these microstructures is to study them even in more details. So we have categorized the A component of CAP by putting them into machine learning or artificial intelligence, fuzzy algorithms. And we have classified them using the KNN and also other like support vector machine and so on and so forth. So by that, we studied this big data. And it turns out that we can classify these signals into different specific subcategories or subclasses. For instance, when we have A and B, that's fine. Okay, we know that. We can even label them by I. But A can also be subcategorized into other further components. We have A1, we have A2A, A2B, and A3. And this is because of the similarity index when we're talking about the school of entropy between the different signals that we have here. So we're putting them together, doing the analysis, doing the classifications, and using the the clustering methods by that we have had come up with A1, A2A, A2B, and A3. And it was shown that A1 is the most significant part of the A phase of CAP, which is important. Why is that salient? Because if we can pinpoint the localization, the source of element of the CAPs in the brain, and at the same time, the subject has some issues with, let's say, attention. Okay, so, and there is a sleep problem. When we solve and we treat the sleep problem, coming back to the patient, getting the EEG, has the sleep problem resolution been resulting in an improved distribution of A1 CAP in that area of the brain? I mean, that this should have been fading away after the sleep is corrected. The A1 should not be there as much as it used to be. Okay, so by that we see that, okay, this sleep predicament has been removed, has been corrected, and that has reflected into the cognitive aptitude. So by time also we may eradicate these A1 phase of the CAP signals and their signatures, their carry-on effect during wakefulness also to get rid of them, because the more we have this slowness activity, which is in the slow activities, which is in the rate of theta activity or delta theta activity in the frontal part of the brain, then we have hampered function of the dorsal attentional network and ventral attentional network. So that's really something which is going hand in hand with cognitive neuroscience and sleep disorders. So if you would like to say, if you would like to put it like maybe cognitive sleep neuromedicine, yeah, if that makes any sense. And this is a video, I'm not sure if I can play it, but that video shows the dynamic of these things. This is not fixed in place. So if we are just taking a 1 minute video, we'll see that there is a moment changes in the distribution, both a spectral and spatial distribution of the brain when the subject is experiencing N2 sleep. So this is the epoch analysis of N2 showing moment by moment changes of the distribution. But we are using the statistical model and the group statistics, not only in one person, but almost 104 cases. And it shows that the distribution of this segment of A1, of ACAP is here, B is there, and so on. Not only that, besides CAPs, we have the, as I said before, we have the sleep spindles. And further to sleep spindles, there's another microstructure label in the brain, which is called K complexes. And the K goes back to the name of the scientist who first coined this. It was Dr. Kale. So Dr. Kale and Dr. Rakshafan, they developed the first, well-organized understanding of the modern sleep science and sleep medicine. So these K complexes are the imprints of the thalamocortical networks, and they are being recorded at the cortical hops. When we have this like a short and transient scape of the thalamocortical oscillatory pathways, oscillatory signals like efferent pathways are getting excited. So the EPSPs will reach the brain, the cortex, and when we have the heightened amplitude, but that's very transient. So it's like a complex. It's got upstroke and downstroke and done, okay? So this is called K complexes. So we sort of were kind of thinking if like when there is a discussion between the thalamus and the frontal cortex in N2, then the brain still can process the data, and there is like a gateway still in place between the anterior thalamus and the frontal areas of the brain. So we have the limbic connections with the anterior thalamus and the prefrontal cortex. So the frontal cortical areas of the brain are still functioning in N2, so memory processing could be happening in a better aptitude. So sort of we hypothesize that perhaps in the elderly with cognitive deficits, this is not the case. So we were looking for, and we kind of hypothesized that perhaps in patients with cogniform disorder or those who are experiencing earlier stages of Alzheimer's disease, or like I was telling you, I was sharing with you, we have published a study recently in the Scandinavia Journal of Sleep Medicine. And in that report, we compared two arms of the patients, one with cogniform disorder and the other arm will help the controls. So we did, these were like 74 cases in general. And we did the polysomnography in a hospital setting, and we had a big data, and we went for the data management and health informatics with our colleagues in Turkey, in Panama. Also, we have very, very solid collaborations with our artificial intelligence machine learning colleagues in India and in the US. So yeah, we did some sort of analysis on this data, and it turns out in four categories, there is a significant difference between the some sleep bioparameters in cognitive form disorder cases and healthy controls. And they were including latency to N1 or shallow sleep, latency to N2 or non-REM stage 2 sleep, N1 proportion and N3 proportion. And apparently we know that in N3, in terms of N3, there is a disruption in N3 structure in elderly population, especially those who experience or who start to express presentations of mild cognitive impairment or Alzheimer's disease or dementia. So the interesting part of the study findings was that we had disappearance of K complexes. We have a significantly decreased proportion and distribution of K complexes in cognitive form disorder cases as compared to healthy control. So it looks like that we got to be saying goodbye to our K complexes as we age, right? So, and from the other side of the story, if someone appears to have disappearance of K complexes in the frontal parts of the brain, and mainly in the frontal parts of the brain, because in the central parts of the brain and in the parietal areas of the brain, central parietal, okay, that's fine. But in the frontal part of the brain, we are really dependent to our K complexes when we are reprocessing them and reconsolidating data during N2 sleep. And by that, we see that, well, this disappearance and this proportionately decreased number of K complexes are more in the central parietal areas of the brain and less in the frontal part of the brain. So the more we have disappearance of the K complexes in the frontal part of the brain, then something wrong is there. Something get really not good, not right. So these can be potentially, this is one of the initial studies that we need to carry on further investigations on that and build upon other research findings from across the field to see whether there is a cross correlation, a solid one, between K complexes, slow sleep spindles or fast sleep spindles, and more importantly, CAP that we highlighted today with cognitive functions. So these are QEEGs, and we have been doing some sort of empirical research with our collaborators using other imaging modalities, including fMRI and fNIRS, a functional near-infrared spectroscopy. We have not had the MEG so far, together with our colleagues, we are running a sub-analysis of this research that you see that was published a while ago, but it was like 10-15 years ago that they published this, but the carry-on phase of this project is being done both in Europe and in the US, that we're actually getting involved in a part of that. The study is being registered in the clinicaltrial.gov, and that's the cross correlation between the sleep duration and the resting state fMRI functional connectivity. So it shows that those who had short sleep, those were short sleepers, they perceive to have hampered daytime functionality, or they do not perceive to have hampered daytime functionality. They are found to have some changes and processing and reprocessing of the visual data set, of the auditory data set, and also in the motor sensory data set. So in terms of the ideomotor skills and visual or acoustic aptitude, we see that those who have had amount hours of reported sleep, they have had a better processing and reprocessing or both signal functionality. So the ROA were in the superior temporal gyrus when the subjects were submitted to visual data set. It was in the left superior temporal gyrus when they were again, submitted to a similar set of data, visual data set. And the occipital region of activity seat was in the auditory data set. So it shows that when they have enough amount of sleep in terms of quantity and quality, then the brain plays a role in processing and reprocessing of the sensory data in sleep. So that's the key point. So when we're talking about sensory data reprocessing in a sleep, that is something really salient that we need to extend our research activities on. Also, we know that regions for the functional connectivity were significantly covariant by the report duration. So the more the subjects reported the sleep duration, the more areas in the brain had like connectivity with the ROIs, and the connectivity within the ROIs that we're looking for, like central parietal and frontal areas of the brain, were more salient in those who had reported a sufficient total sleep time. So in the bottom of the panel left side, you will see that there are some hot spots that are some, you know, hot colors. In the very frontal part of the brain, it's called frontopolar areas, and also we have the central parietal in the last column but one, the right side. So these areas are the areas that are positively showing a robust connectivity, functional connectivity in fMRI. So if you look at the similar findings from the same study, it shows that the researchers and the reporters of that finding and investigation report, there is a functional connectivity, and there is a correlation. There is a solid link between functional connectivity and sleep duration. So the more sleep duration is, the more solid and dependable functional connectivity features will be there. It could be different neural systems in the brain and cortical areas, ranging from a primary auditory cortex, a primary motor cortex, a primary somatosensory cortex, and primary visual. So it is apparent that we're just talking about the correlation index of the both signals when the subjects are being submitted to any of these specific tasks and they were allowed to have a nap or they were being studied overnight. From another perspective, where you're just putting this together in the kind of matrix connectivity meshwork analysis. So you're just, for example, here we have the primary auditory cortex and the component, principal component one. So what is the principal component one? The primary auditory cortex. So primary auditory cortex, you see that they are correlated. And also with the primary motor cortex, there is a positive weight. And some of them are positively loaded, some of them are negatively loaded, some of them are sort of neutral. So you see the most changes and the most positive or negative loading, predominantly positive loading, is within the principal component two of the brain mapping that this study have had. So it shows that for the components of the principal components two, the more we have the weighting, the more we have functional connectivity, and there is a cross correlation, positively correlated. The functional connectivity is positively correlated with the sleep duration. But in some other studies, they also did show that it is not about having more and more and more sleep to let the brain function better. And some studies have highlighted that having more than 9 hours of sleep over 24 hours, it's not for the brain. So some functional, emotional aptitude, cognitive, motor, and sensory functions will get negatively hampered and disrupted. So these cases who come up with less than 6 hours of reported sleep duration per night, then some of them would report dysfunction. They come to the clinic, they would say, yeah, I do have neuroticism, I do have anxiety, I cannot control myself, my impulse control is so weak. Some others, they deny the dysfunction. They have this extroversion behavior. They have this hypomania. They are very happy. I'm Superman. I don't sleep, and I can still function really well. And when we do the evaluation, we see that those who come with the reported dysfunction in the short term without any environmental stimulation, they would have decreased connectivity in sensory motor cortex to the caudate and putamen and cerebellum. So by that, they would have an increased head motion, difficulty maintaining wakefulness. So they have this urge, and they have this propensity to go for sleep. And so in short run, there is a theory showing that, well, those who sleep less and they are happy, they are not expressing any specific complaint. Maybe in short run, if you are testing them within, for example, like a couple of weeks after this abrupt bolts of sleep deprivation, sleep restriction, you will see that there is an increased connectivity between the sensory motor cortex to hippocampus to amygdala and a remaining sensory cortex. And why is that? Because the brain is using the cognitive reserve, because the brain is just struggling to catch up with the situation. Because the brain has got this like interplay between the cortical subcortical areas of the brain, and the sensory motor areas of the brain are getting linked even more in depth and more and stronger and with the deep-seated limbic structures, including hippocampus and amygdala and sensory regions. But by time, we'll see that, well, that we also have increased head motion, and we have difficulty maintaining wakefulness. And by time, you'll see that these cases will go back to sleep. They need to go back to sleep because they owe some sleep debt to their sleep bank. And the dividend, the profit for this loan is too high. So when you go to sleep, then it's very, very different. And you have REM rebound. And also, they might be having some increased memory consolidation, overdreaming, something like that. So by time, the brain has been using this maximum capacity of overt functioning. And that leads to accelerated aging. So this has been shown that to be positively related to accelerated aging, when we're talking about the middle agers, that they have ranges of sleep disorders, they are found to have a more prevalent proportion of cases with cognitive decline, with myocognitive impairment, and ultimately with Alzheimer's disease. And together with our colleagues in Swiss Alternative Medicine in Geneva, we came up with a model. We're sort of putting together all the different variables that they are contributing to the overall health, to our inclusive brain health. One of the main pillars of this column, of this model, if you can locate it in the down left corner of this model, is sleep and wakefulness. So sleep is sort of related to nutrition and physical activity, to allostatic stress load, and also to genetics. And everything is related here. We got a cross-correlational paradigm between all different variables. You see the neural system domain, that we have CNS, central nervous system, ANS, autonomic nervous system, and PNS, peripheral nervous system. So that's the black upright triangle. Also, you see the red circle here, that we have the behavior, emotion, and cognition. So there is like a trilateral interface between behavior, emotion, and cognition. And also, we a little while ago touched on the green square. We have four main variables that you're sort of defining are like brain-friendly lifestyle, if you like. And lastly, when we talk about the inverted yellow triangle, we discuss about the cross-correlation between the body, brain, and surrounding. And there is a way to quantify how the person is doing in terms of any of these variables. We've got questionnaires for any of these variables, putting together these interrelations with quantitative measures. We're labeling them with figures and facts, and by that, the subject is going to be plotted somewhere in this model. So the optimal goal is that we sit somewhere here. So there is a harmony between CNS, ANS, PNS. There's a harmony between brain, emotion, cognition, harmony between body and brain and surrounding. And there is a harmony, and there is a rule in place for all different aspects of the epigenetic and environmental factors that they are sort of contributing to our functionality and health. And I'm so thankful to all of you for turning in, and I hope that this almost short presentation, I hope that I haven't made you bored, but this almost short presentation have opened some new horizons and some new thoughts in your brain. Maybe we can think of the importance of of sleep in a way that we do much things together. So we got to be working together. Let's do it. Thank you very much for listening, everybody.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Naomi. It was a very nice presentation, as usual. As you mentioned, sleep is an important field in clinical and also basic neuroscience research. And I hope that your presentation opened a view for the audience to start thinking about doing research in neuroscience, in sleep neuroscience. Okay. So my question is regarding the research that you have done in sleep duration, actually. I want to know if there is any possibility to see the same phases in awake condition, for example, in resting state. I mean, there are many, you know, I mean, there are many resting state studies. I want to know, I mean, is there any study that they have compared those phases that you mentioned, A and B phase, for example, in during the awake and during the sleep condition, and you can see also the same conditions in specific conditions during awake, for example, I don't know, maybe during after sleep, few moments after sleep or whatever.
Yes, Dr. Delery, as you pointed out, Professor, there's a lot of untapped questions and untraveled avenues here. So we need to go hand in hand and do hypothesize some research questions and think about how we can explore, how we can unravel remaining and a pile of existing questions, as you pointed out one of them. The question is how we can cross-correlate the functional connectivity of the larger scale brain networks during wakefulness and sleep. So if someone does the QEEG or EEG analysis quantitatively during wakefulness, by looking at it, can we sort of, predict that this person by this risk profile or this chance has the risk profile for insomnia, has a risk profile for nightmare disorder, and vice versa. If you do the sleep EEG, if you do the sleep brain mapping, can you kind of label the prediction, a sort of a prediction model when we're using the AI machine learning? Is there like a supervised learning model to guess about by what level this sleep EEG predicts, you know, the connectivity map of the diurnal function of the same individual? So there should be a crosstalk between the analysis of the brain signals in wakefulness EEG or fMRI and also during wake. We haven't done it yet so far, specifically for the phase A or B of the CAP signals, no, for CAP cycles, no, we just did the QEEG during wake sleep. But that would be an interesting question to tap into. We can get some QEEGs in a specific, you know, time domains during the wakefulness, for example, like 10 to 12 a.m., then we cross-correlate. We sort of do the correlation analysis of the EEG of the wakefulness and sleep EEG and find out about the role of CAP here and all other different things which kind of resemble the arousal instability. Great question, yeah.
Okay, thank you. Aliraza Rahman Sutayesh. So he's asking, is it difference to sleep from 10 p.m. to 7 a.m. or 3 a.m. to 12 p.m.? The duration is the same, but when to go to bed is different.
Yes, Mr. Aliraza, that's right. But I'm sorry to say that's a negative answer. So it's a no. Why? Because when we're talking about the circadian rhythm, and our brain has been hardwired to experience the slumber overnight. And that is not only about us, about so many other mammals, apart from the rodents that are, you know, opposite human, but many mammals are doing like us. For example, cat. It sleeps at night, it functions during the day. So the brain has this interplay and machinery of the chemicals, electrical activity, and genetic profile, and the protein buildup. Everything is well designed, is well coordinated. So the whole brain is orchestrated into a functional paradigm, into a functional model activity overnight hours. Some genes are expressed only during the night. That's why when we travel, when we have the jet lag, we got confused about the timing, then we find it difficult to follow or maintain a sleep. And that takes time. So this re-engineering takes time. And when we are depriving ourselves from nighttime sleep, then we are combating our physiology. Some people, deliberately and undeliberately, they are, you know, kind of delaying their sleep phase. So they sleep late, they wake up late. Although they are sleeping like 6 hours, 7 hours, 8 hours, over 24 hours, but the timing is fine. The phase is not. It's out of phase. Because that is out of phase, it does not have the good physiological smoothing effect on our endocrinological system, neurological system, psychobehavioral system, and also our genetics. So as much as we can, we need to stick to the regular schedule of nocturnal sleep. And if someone is about to take night shifts, or someone is like shift worker and has got no other option but to stay awake overnights and to catch up sleep then during the day, that should be a fair schedule. These should not move on for more than 5 years. And according to the research which was published in University of Southern California in 2017, they have the state regulation for this. So no one is allowed to take shift work services for more than 5 years. And you've got to be changing the shift work schedule or they got to get retired. Because they showed that this is going to result in detrimental, serious, and very, very noticeable cognitive changes, and that would increase the incidence of Alzheimer's or cognitive decline and the burden of the disease in the society. So the wise thinking is to stick to night hours for sleep. Thank you for asking. Hope that kind of answered your question.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Nami. Is there any other question? Okay, Adirza is asking another question.
Yeah, I shared with you something about that. Just you Google it and go to any of the textbooks in the sleep and also in neuroscience, you will see that there is an evolution between there is an evolutionary justification for the nighttime sleep, and not only human. Not only primates, not only mammals or vertebrates, even in non-vertebrates, even in very, very simple animals, even in one single, you know, cell creature like a fungus, okay, you see that the movement, the activity is changed based on two factors, the timing of the day or night, and also the place where the food is. So food and the timing and the light exposure, these are the things that the brain has been hardwired throughout the animal kingdom to get down to sleep and to stay awake, run, and work during some hours. Yes, please, Dr. Purtakdust. Dr. Purtakdust, maybe she wants to ask questions.
Thanks for a nice presentation.
Sure.
I had this question that I heard once that some scientists have this idea that maybe practicing meditation can increase the alpha waves production. And also I heard another presentation that some kind of sound frequencies can induce dizziness and the feeling of sleep. I don't have this idea. I don't know that these ideas have any scientific validity, but I want to know your opinion about this, that we can induce sleep with some frequencies or some mindfulness practicings.
Sure. Yeah, great question. Thank you. Well, our team, we've been involved with a set of research doing some studies on a specific sort of meditation practices, which is called geometric meditation or FGM. So this geometric meditation, we thought that this might be kind of correlated to changes in brain function, even plasticity effects or plastic changes in the brain. And we have had in clinical practice, I had a colleague of mine who came from University of Bangalore, and he's been doing human consciousness research. So in Shiraz, I got a chance of meeting him like 10 years ago. We started to run a research, very small scale research. And we start to validate this FGM on the brain of some individuals that they were doing, because it has like many different techniques. This meditation practice has different techniques. So, and we published that the effect of each technique on the brain in our study population differs state by state, case by case. And we went for the group of statistics and published it. So if you search FGM, you see, you know, a handful of papers that we have, we and our other team members have been trying to show the clinical relevance and also the scientific ground truth for this. And also some of the techniques that they are combined, the meditation with relaxation techniques, of course, they would decrease the tension, they would decrease muscle tension, they would decrease they would increase a better flow of the oxygen. The inner flow will get enhanced. The person will have decreased like resistance, surface resistance of the skin. Also, the person's sympathetic drive in terms of the moment by moment variability in the heart rate, something we call it heart rate variability, this is being changed. And at the same time, we have these changes in the brain oscillations of the brain wave patterns. And if you remember the inclusive brain health model that when I put it at one of my last slides.
Yes, I can remember.
But yeah, this is like a cross-link between ANS, CNS, and PNS. So meditating sort of harmonizes the ANS, CNS, and PNS interface. So the more we do a proper, well-educated meditation, the more we get approached to the center of that triangle. That's about the meditation. And if you just search meditation, brain EEG, and sleep, you will see many papers coming up, and there is a huge, satisfying, compelling evidence supporting the beneficial effects of meditation, mindfulness-based practices for the better mental sleep, number one. Number two is that if we're going to use technology to entrain the brain waves, for instance, we're using the two-ear administration of a specific brain waves in sort of acoustic stimuli, which is called binaural acoustic beat, or BAB. For instance, this ear is going to hear a voice which is like 16 hertz. This one is going to catch the voice which is 10 hertz. So 16 minus 10 minus 10, we have the overlay of 6 hertz oscillation entrainment in the midline plane of the brain. So some areas, including the anterior cingulate cortex, is getting entrained by a 6 hertz oscillatory pattern, which has been generated, which has been received and imprinted by what? By this binaural acoustic beat. So there are many compelling evidence supporting this, and at the same time, there are people who are overclaiming. There are people who are not scientific. There are people who are talking too much. There are people who are, trying to get money out of this. There are people who are marketing this without any scientific evidence, and they are misusing the technology for that. So there is some evidence, and we need to be very, 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 to observe the data. If something is not there, we're not going to claim it. If something is there, then we'll discuss about it. So evidence-based medicine is all that I'm talking about here. Something is within the circle of evidence-based medicine, take it. Something is not, let's leave it, all right?
Mm-hmm. Okay, I get it. Thank you for your
Thank you for your question.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Nami, again.
Sure.
Good presentation and your comments.